Welcome to our fourth and final session of our Advent retreat, looking at the O Antiphons. So today we will spend time reflecting on the last antiphon, O Emmanuel. To those joining us for the first time, I thank you for your presence. And you can always check out the Franciscan Institute website and go on the Facebook page, and you can retrieve the previous retreats. So before we begin, I would invite us to choose a candle and look at it. Let it engage you. Look at its flame, look at its color. And as you do that, just try to relax. Leave maybe the baking or the house cleaning or all the things that would distract you behind. Let it go. You will return to it. It's safe. Nobody will take it. Nobody would even do the work for you. You know that, right? Unless you have a very kind husband, a kind wife, or a kind child, or somebody, some granny. So let's just enter into the quiet. Pick a candle, or if you want the whole wreath, and just look at it. Think of what light means for you. Think of the time when you were in darkness and you needed light, physically, spiritually, and even socially. And as you become friends with that candle, then I would invite you to close your eyes and continue to see that candle, see that light. Feel its warmth. See its glow. Maybe see the glow on your face from the candle reflecting its light on you. The glow around you, from the reflection of the candle, and sit in that light. And imagine that light, not only in your surroundings and on your face, but that light is penetrating, begin to slowly penetrate your body. And that light is the light of goodness, the light of Christ. The light and the warmth of healing. Of vision and clarity. Of enlightenment and discernment. The light and the inspiration that comes from Scripture, the Word of God. That becomes a light onto your path, a guide onto your feet, If your hands are closed, I ask you to invite you to open up your hands and let that light be held in your hands. Let it be there and think of someone you want to offer that light to. Situation where you want to shed light, you want to bring light into that situation. I ask you to the spirit of the prayer that you are in, just mentally, or you can say it out loud if you would like, but just say a word of prayer. Whether it's to thank God for the light, whether it's to pray to be light for others, whether it's to pray that you yourself may walk in the light. And in the spirit of Christmas, the spirit of Christ coming into the world, the dawn that breaks through, I invite us just to stretch our hands out and just give that light to the world. Let us bless ourselves in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So today, as I said, we contemplate and pray with O Emmanuel, which is the last of the O Antiphons, which you will normally pray on December 23rd. Our King and our Lawgiver, the hope of the nations and their Savior. Come, and save us, O Lord our God. So with every O antiphon, we have been praying in the last phrase, come and do something. So today we pray, come and save us, O Lord our God. We started out with, O wisdom, O sapienza, come and bring us wisdom. Come and show us your goodness. And today we're really going to see the goodness of God as God breaks into human history. Where the prophet Isaiah prophesied that the Lord will give us a sign. A woman with child would be a son and shall name him Emmanuel. And that is picked up in the New Testament by Matthew and by Luke. So today you would have listened to that gospel, which really speaks of this prophecy of Isaiah. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God with us. You know, Mary's yes, Mary's fiat, is something to really ponder on. It's something to really take into prayer. I was very much struck this week by the response of Zechariah and the response of Mary. I had never been struck by it so forcefully as I was this week. So I will invite you during the week to read the story of Zechariah and read the story of Mary. Because I've been trying to follow these stalwarts of Advent, these characters that convey the Advent spirit to us. And I was struck by the fact that both Zechariah and Mary said that they were afraid. The angel had to tell both of them, fear not. But Mary, her idea, you know, what comes across is that Mary is concerned. Mary wants to understand. So when she is greeted by this, well, I mean, it's more than an affirmation. All I could call it is a wonderful greeting. Hail Mary, full of grace. Man, it kind of threw in a tailspin what this could mean. Full of grace. And then the angel went on to tell us that she would be a son. She would conceive and be a son. And Mary wants to understand that. And she says, but I'm a virgin. So she's basically asking the question, help me understand this, how this will happen. And the angel just said to her, Mary, look, the Spirit of God will hover over you, and the child that you will bear is his son. And you know Mary's response as well as I do. And Mary just said, be it done unto me according to your word. I am the handmaid of the Lord. I am the servant of God's word. I am the vessel that carry whatever you want me to carry. I am here for your purpose. Now, Zechariah, on the other hand, is afraid. And the angel had to tell him, don't be afraid, which was the same thing he said to Mary, don't be afraid. And what I was struck by, Zechariah is reassured. The angel said to him, Zechariah, be assured that your prayer has been heard. Just think about it. I would love to hear that. I would love to see some angel or see some writing on the wall that says, be assured, Julie, your prayers have been heard. Wouldn't you? Be assured that your prayers have been heard. And your wife will bear a son. But this is the difference between Zechariah and Mary. And Zechariah's response to that was, how can I believe this? How can I believe this? Even when the angel said to him, the angel went to pains and said to him, you know, listen, this is what will happen. And, you know, I am the one that was sent by God. I'm Gabriel. I stand between before you and before God. And I was sent by God. All of this explanation is going on. And Zechariah said, I can't believe. And here is Mary. Be done unto me. If I'm to be honest, I live sometimes in both camps. You know, choosing to be as Mary is. That's why, you know, Mary is called the Ark of the Covenant. In the first reading of today, we read about the Ark and what is carried in the Ark. The Ten Commandments, the covenant between God and human persons, the staff of Aaron and the rod of Moses and bread. That was what filled the Ark. And if you take it symbolically, for any person of faith, what should fill us? What should engage us in our interior being? Is that covenant that we have with God, that we made in baptism? That word of God that is a staff for us. That word of God that becomes a rod and guidance for us. In faith, that is what becomes the dwelling place of God. That is what the prophet was saying today, you know, we'll make a place for you. We'll create a temple for you. No, the temple, that dwelling place needs to be inside of us. Inside of us. And Mary was able somehow, in her faith, to accept God at his word. So Christmas really is not an occasion. It's not a party, it's not decoration. Christmas is a process, and that process began in Mary. Christ coming, Christ must come, is a process. It begins with God sending his son to this teenage woman, and her fiat, her yes, allows God to enflesh himself in her. And that Holy Spirit will overshadow you. The Holy Spirit just doesn't only overshadow Mary. As a matter of fact, if you look at the sacramental theology of confirmation, the Holy Spirit just don't overshadow us. We say of ourselves through that sacrament, we receive the gifts of the Holy Spirit. The point is, can we all say yes to it? Can we say fiat? Can we make our fiat? Can we say yes to it, to the gifts of the Holy Spirit? Can we say yes to the life of the Holy Spirit in us so that God's life may take flesh, God's word may take flesh in us? And we're not talking magic here, you know. What we're really talking is about availability. Am I available for God? Am I an instrument that God can use? And to be available, we have to die to self. We have to make space for God. We have to die to this false ego. We have to be willing to embrace change. Mary's yes wasn't a one-time said and done. That's why I say Christmas is a process. To live Christmas is to enter into a journey with Christ. That Christ, even after giving birth to Christ in the world, there is another way to carry Christ in us. And that is through obedience to his will. That fear was just an introduction to that obedience. And all of us could look at our lives and see when we have said yes and said it in all our honesty, in all our desire to be good, in all our desire to grow in holiness and to grow in the spiritual life. We know that that yes costs something. For Mary, it costs her a flight into Egypt. It costs her becoming an immigrant, looking for welcome, running with a child trying to save his life. That's no self-option. But faith is no self-option. We never know where our faith will take us, what it will ask of us. It may ask of us courage in the face of a terminal illness. It may ask of us courage in the face of having, you know, to have hope, to stand with a child who is really giving us problems, a marriage that is really turning out to not what we wanted or even thought it would be. Journeying with some mentally ill family member. The yes that requires the patience of Job. And the perseverance and faith of Abraham. That enfleshing of Jesus that Mary took on by her yes, that we in our own frail humanity try to take on by saying yes to God, can lead us to homelessness. Homelessness, by that I mean where even sometimes our own family want to ask us, what do you think you're playing? You're holy more than thou? What is that? You know, when even in speaking the truth, we experience rejection. But yes, saying yes to God, Mary's yes to God, really is the inbreaking and the allowing for the inbreaking of God's mystery in our life, in the life of the world. And that is what brings hope. That is what brought hope to the people of Israel. That their suffering was not in vain. Richard Rohr, one of my favorite Franciscan writers, says of hope, he says that the virtue of hope is with great irony, because it is the fruit of a learned capacity to suffer wisely, calmly, and generously. Mary's yes brought that hope to us. A hope in which she herself learned to suffer wisely, calmly, and generously. Indeed, the Lord will be there with us. Majestic, yes, the Lord our judge, the Lord our lawgiver, the Lord our king. He it is who will save us. Let us pray for the grace as we continue to journey this Advent season, as we approach Christmas. That we really can put our trust in God. We really can reprioritize our life in a way that gives God prominence, first place, prime time. Because God is indeed here with us. So in this last antiphon, our expectation finds joy now in the certainty of fulfillment. So when we celebrate the Christ child, that fulfillment is not only found in a stable, in a crib. But in the begging hands on the road, in the expectation and hope that we see in the eyes of the Venezuelans walking the street, or other persons who have had to flee their own country. The first reading today speaks of captivity. We are only held captive if we knew a home. We can only say that, you know, I'm in exile, I'm captive, because there was a relationship there that got broken. Maybe the people who welcomed Mary and Joseph and the infant king in Egypt, maybe what they saw was a longing, a hope in the eyes of this family looking for a place. Christmas challenges us not only to become a dwelling place for God, but to be a dwelling place for God. Remember what Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, reminds us of. When I was hungry, you gave me to eat. I was thirsty, you gave me to drink. Homeless, and you gave me shelter. To reach out in situations like that is to prepare and to become a dwelling place for God. Francis of Assisi, to whom every sister in my congregation makes vows under that patronage of St. Francis. Francis gave the world the Christmas crib. And Francis did not give the world the Christmas crib to put trinkets and balloons and all lights and all the kinds of fancy things that we do and Christ gets lost. Francis gave the crib to the world so that we may never forget the humility of God. The God who humbled himself and took on our humanity. The God who sent his son to say, human beings are good. I can become part of your reality so that you can become part of my divinity. Francis never wanted us to forget our smallness, which Jesus would say in his ministry to his disciples, when they're fighting for power, become like this little child. Francis never wanted us to forget that. Be this little child. That's why he gave us the Christmas crib. Like Dominic gave us the rosary, Francis gave us the crib. So that we could always be in relationship, in adoration. Knowing that God, Emmanuel, is with us. That calls us to interior conversion and transformation, a change of heart. It calls us to see not just with our naked eyes, but with the eyes of love. Not with the eyes and the thought of I am better than or I am worse than, but with the eyes and the heart of I am as good as, they are as good as. We all are good. Christmas is the celebration of goodness, generosity, God's goodness, God's generosity, God's overflowing love to us. So as we make this last week of our journeying towards Christmas, I would ask and invite us to look at the many ways in which Emmanuel is with us. For those of us who are from the Catholic tradition, God is with us in many ways, and God is with us in Eucharist. And Eucharist for us should never just be ritual, sacramental ritual. This God with us is a constant reminder that we are not abandoned. This God with us, who said, "Do this in remembrance of me. Every time you do this, remember. Make me again a member of your community. Remember, I am with you." For us, Eucharist and reception of Eucharist should make us more Eucharistic people. In the sharing spirit of Christmas, am I willing, like Eucharist, to be broken, to be blessed, to be shared, to be given, to be eaten even? God with us. Because Francis gave us a crib for Christmas and at Christmas to celebrate the humility of Christ, Francis could pray that the body of Christ in every church in the entire universe, where it's not revered and respected, honored and glorified in our life, Francis prayed a prayer of contrition and pardon. I invite us, especially those of us from the Catholic tradition, what's our attitude to Eucharist? Is God really with us? Do we consume Eucharist as our old grandparents used to tell us, you eat to live or you live to eat? Well, according to the prayer that we say at Mass, is that we may have life, we may eat and have life and have it eternal. That this body may never bring us condemnation. This Eucharist may never bring us condemnation, but health in mind and body. So as Pope Francis would say, every single thing is connected. Every single thing is connected. So I pray that this Christmas, we may really see the connection of everything, the oneness that Christ came and brought to us. So that Gentile and Jew, kings and shepherds, wise men, all can find Christ and all can be guided by the star, the light. And at his name, every knee shall bend and every head shall bow. So we started our journey with O Wisdom, and we prayed, as I said, for prudence and for God's goodness. And then O Adonai, O Lord, and we prayed to come and save us with outstretched arm. And O Root of Jesse, and we prayed, come and deliver us and delay no longer. And O Key of David, come and lead your people out of prison and the darkness and the shadow of death. O Rising Sun, come and enlighten those who walk in darkness and the shadow of death. O King of Nations, come and save the human race that you've created and fashioned out of clay. And finally, O Emmanuel, come and save us. O Lord our God. So as we go through this last couple of days, you can integrate any of these O antiphons as you remember them. Just pray them wherever you are. And save Christmas. Rescue the infant king from the trappings of commercialization and all the other things that strangle Christ out of Christmas. So I wish each of you and your families a very, very prayerful, happy, and I mean happy, Christmas. I thank you really for participating in the last four Sundays of or whatever you were able to join us, whenever you were able to join us. I ask that we continue to pray for each other, even though you don't know everybody by name who have made this journey with us, but pray for the O Antiphon people that made this journey. So, again, thanks. And we would end with our last slide where we could listen to O Come Emmanuel. And then I think you were invited, if you wanted to, but you're in your homes most likely, or possibly in your car, I don't know where you are, but most likely the majority of you in your home. You can always get something that you like to eat and to drink, and then we can have our ushering of our Christmas. Is to take your right hand, put over your left shoulder, your left hand over your right shoulder. And as you embrace yourself, say, O Emmanuel, God with me. O Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. Thank you very much. So I hope you really know that God is with you, right? So very good. Very good.